Well, thank you for the invitation. It says, nope, can't do that. That's good enough. Because now, if you're using some function that some colleague has written that has some annotations about what you expect, so you're using the wrong way, you don't have to check if you're using the wrong way or not. Flow does it for you. It just takes mental load off of the development process. If Flow doesn't complain, and you have everything covered, you are reasonably sure that what you're doing makes sense from the type perspective. Now, this doesn't mean that you're sure that your code is correct and does what you want. That's a logic problem. There's no tool in the world that can solve it. But at least you will know that you're using code the way it was intended. Flow does a lot of what it does by using something called time inference. Time inference basically just means that you don't need to write a lot of annotations for Flow to figure out what's going on. It will do its best effort at giving some annotations, conclude things about your code. So in this example, I've said takes number, takes an argument, well, time number. Then I said a function proxy calls takes number. And you'll see that the argument of takes number in proxy is the argument of proxy. And then I call it to the string. But the takes number expects a number. And Flow will figure this out. It will say, well, you're passing a string to proxy, and proxy is passing whatever that is to takes number. And takes number expects a number. So there's a problem. And it does this way, through function calls. And it also does this through just some basic concepts of the language. For example, the multiplication operator doesn't work in strings. So if you try to read a string, Flow complains. These two things together, Flow knowing a little bit about how the basic types in the language work, and figuring out things across functions, means that you really only need to type a relatively small percentage of your code to get coverage and get benefits in a lot of it. Basically, if you type the lowest level functions you have, the ones that operate in the most basic data, I wouldn't say halfway, you're a good way along the way of having decent coverage. In addition to type inference, the other thing that's really useful is type operations. Let's say that there's something that's always the same type that you want to use all over the place. You don't want to keep declaring that type everywhere, so you just write in lines. You say, my type is the same thing as number. Well, this is a really simple case, but you'll see ahead of my type could also be a certain shape of an object, or could be an array of a certain type. And you can also do the same thing in functions. You say, well, here's a function, or there's a type that says that if I give this to a function, then it'll be a function of number. Then I can declare square to be a function. I don't mention to write the types myself. You can only use the syntax with error functions, but you can do something similar with normal functions. Just need to type the input and the return separately. You can still use it. So these syntaxes, you can declare what your types are separately from where you use them, and that's just the basic principle of the program. If you try to write something once, you need to change it. Talk a little bit about React. Is everyone up to speed by now? I don't have any questions. Okay. Talk a little bit about React Native. So, React components, at their basic, are really just a function of some input to some UI. You can talk about IR components and you can talk about containers and whatever. If you look at a simple React component, you're giving something and you're taking out some UI. And this concept translates to other UI frameworks. And the input is really, which is called props, is really just an object with a lot of things inside of it. So the way you use Flow in React is by saying, here's a type which is an object that I was referring to earlier, and has two properties. True, which is a number, and bar, which might or not be here, that's what the question mark means, which is a string. And then you say, well, my component just uses props. Don't worry about the weird angle brackets and how that is different from JavaScript, that doesn't really matter, it's just a bad. The point here is, is figure out the shape of the drops and write a font. And you, if you're using React, you're probably already doing that because you're using prop types. And really the only difference is that prop types is checked at runtime, and this is checked at compile time. And we'll see why that is nice. This also works in state, so if you're compiling a state, again, state is just an object which just describes what it is and also has an index of the type parameter, then there's a function no difference there. And yeah, it also works with stateless function components. The syntax is slightly different because instead of extending class, you declare the type of the, with the argument of your function, which is the input into your component. I also have a bunch of space in this slide, so here's the right. So, to sum up, using React with Flow is really simple. That's because React is a really simple library in Flow. You can't be wrong, it's really complex, so it does learn who is possible. But the interface for the programming is really simple. So, there's no prop types. You check the props are checked before runtime. If you mess up with passing props in your code, you're going to get an error when you're writing it, you're not going to get an error when you're running it. That's great. Because it gets rid of weird errors in production, and we all know that. So Flow checks both component usage, that is, am I using this component correctly? Is what I'm passing into it correct? Is that what the component should receive? And also prop usage inside of the component. That is, given what I have received from the outside, am I as a component behaving correctly? Am I using the props like I should? And that's the part that gets you rid of canonical prop types in the front. Because if you try to access something that Flow thinks you didn't actually pass in, it'll come up. And then there's some differences around default props. If you really want to use Flow with React, I recommend you go and read the docs. Again, the Flow docs are really good. But you can also just talk to me afterwards. There's some new ones in different. Something you learn once and then go with it, but there are differences. On to meetups. Now, I'll be honest, I have a very small size of meetups because there's a lot of nuance in using Flow with meetups and you can get really into it, especially if you're using things like Fun or Sagas. So, this is just the basics, but it gives you a good idea of what Flow is good at. In meetups, you'll have a type for your state. Your state is just, again, a big object with a lot of things inside. Now this type is going to be really complex, and you probably want to abstract parts of it into subtypes, or other types, subtype is a little bit but you do other types, so you can grab somewhere else. But in the end, it's just a big object for a lot of things, etc. And this is immutable, and there's a really nice syntax for declaring that, it's in Flow. So you'll be able to make sure that nobody ever mutates your state, which is really important to read it. And it's just a big object. And then you have an action tab. That's what you can dispatch, what you can say is happening at a certain moment. That's really a union of different types. We'll get into what a union is in a little bit, but basically this means action can really be like an update action, or a delete action, or a read action, or whatever. You can have hundreds of different things, right? It's a combination of all of them that form your possible set of actions in this dispatch. And the reducers are just a function of both the state and the action into another state. And that's how you get around the whole immutable thing, that's part of the reducers, that's part of the Flow. But yeah, you get an initial state, you dispatch an action on it, you get an initial state as a result of that transformation. And remember when I said component usage earlier, when I said, oh, Flow checks the props that you pass into a component? That includes connect, which is Redux's way of taking a component and connecting it to your Redux store. So when you declare a container in the container pattern that you normally use in Redux, what you're saying is that here's a component that is a simple dump thing, given some props, it puts out some Y. Here's something that describes how to get data out of the state, and now whenever the state changes, I want my component. When you do that, it's really nice that Flow tells you, wait, I know you're passing in props explicitly, but you're passing them by connecting to the store and what you're getting out of the store, what you're putting into the component, doesn't make sense given what you said or what the component expects. But really, it's just a special case of using components, using components indirectly. So that's to match the problem. And this actually talks. Those need a little bit of magic to work well with flow. There's a really good project, we'll get to that at the end of the slides. And once again, go read the feature box. If you're interested in flow, the flow guide on how to get set up includes talks about how to use specific libraries, especially React-Index, because flow is a Facebook thing, and they're really, really nice. Like, I don't even know why I'm not sure. Some extra points. I call it extra points because this is the main spec of things that I don't know about to call and I don't like naming things, but here's what I want to talk about. What is an exact object? You can use intersections and generics, and then a little bit about the ecosystem around. So exact objects are a really simple concept to understand. It's really just the consequence of what flow thinks about objects. By default, flow allows you put anything you want into an object, as long as you put at least what you declared it has to have. So if I say I have an object with foo and bar, then I put baz and bench into it, flow is fine with it. You probably don't want that all the time, especially with props, for example. Why would you pass extra props into a component? So this is just flow syntax for saying, no. I want to have all of these and nothings. So that's why the second there, that calls E creates an error, because this object can only has to have foo, and can only have foo, cannot have bar. Then the line at the bottom does alternative syntax, but the normal way to use it for props. That in and of itself is not a very interesting concept, it's just useful to know for what it means. So, unions are a way of saying, I want something to be either type A or type B. That means that if you have a function which takes this, the function needs to handle both cases, needs to check am I dealing with type A or am I dealing with type B, and then it needs to make a different function based on that. On the other hand, you can call the function with either one of them. This goes back to the whole action step. When you dispatch an action, you pass something into the dispatch function. And the title of the first argument of the dispatch function is any of these actions. You can pass any one of them. The opposite of that, okay, I will put a little example in here and give you an example through the intersection. The opposite of that is intersection, which is I want something to be both type A and type B. So this function, beat, it will only work if I give it something which is at the same time a person and an animal. That makes really interesting because when you think about this, this is impossible. You can't satisfy this in JavaScript. What I'm asking for something here is something that's a number and a string at the same time. Now, flow will let you compile it, but if you try to use that type, there is no JavaScript you can write that will ever ask that check. But the type is out. Now, this is because that means you can do inheritance. You can have different types, object types, which declare different properties, and then you can say, I want the intersection of all of these. I want an object which contains all of these things. And again, there's two examples. And finally, generics. You don't need generics to have a decent type system, but they're really useful. Generics exist in many languages, between Java or C++, Scala or Haskell, whatever you has. You'll know about generics. This is just a way of saying, I don't know what my type is yet, but I'll know sometime in the future that I'll know. So that identity function, what that means, what the angle brackets are meaning is, given some type, which I'm going to call T for now because I don't have a better name for it, both my first argument and my return type both my first argument and my return are of that type, T. So this function, if it gets a number, it must return a number. If it gets a string, it must return a string, etc., etc., etc. The other side of that coin is that when you use arrays in flow, you can either use an array of anything, because JavaScript allows that, you can have an array of one string object, that's fine. But if you want to have an array that has all the same type in all elements, then you can say, oh, this is an array of numbers. You can only put numbers in there. Or you can say, this is an array of number union string. Then you can only put numbers or strings in there. That's it. Am I lost? So, external libraries and flow types. This is a little bit of a tangent, but it's nice to know if you start using it. If you're using flow, you're probably using some libraries which don't have flow annotations. That's because the way flow works is by adding annotations to your code. So, if the author of the library didn't bother, then you don't have those. And that's bad because it would be nice to know what a library expects, what I should pass it when I call a function. But it would be really, really nice to know what it returns to me, so I can process return values, so I can use the return values from a certain library somewhere else in my code. Otherwise, the moment I get data for a library, I can never trust that the result of that computation from there to the end of the execution. So I can use flow up to the moment where I pass it into libraries, but not afterwards. And that's really a really ties your legs there. So here's FlowDev. FlowDev is a really awesome game project that just is a collection of annotations for common, widely used libraries. That goes for things from Lodash to React to that weird library you have a hook. There's hundreds of them. I think almost 600 vendors right now. They're really strong around the React Linux ecosystem. And they're really good at making DRs, right? Data copies. So if you have a library to use, and you'd like to use flow, but one that doesn't have annotations, maybe spend a couple of days writing those annotations and put a DR. And writing annotations for a library is actually a really nice way of understanding how it works and of wrapping your head around flow. Because you'll be looking at existing code. So all you'll be figuring out is what types that code deals with. You won't be trying to do software architecture at the same time as you're trying to do flow annotations. And finally, this is kind of the elephant in the room. Flow and TypeScript are the two big typed idioms of JavaScript around right now. And which one should you use? Well, it depends on your preference. But if you're using React or Red, it's probably a good idea to use Flow. That's because, again, it's a Facebook project, they interact pretty well. Flow, the annotation checker doesn't really matter, but the thing that removes the annotations from the code, that's a Babel transform. If you're using React, you're most likely using Babel as well. So that plugs in really nicely. It takes a couple of minutes to set up Flow if you're already using Babel and React. But in the end, you have to transpile anyway. Either from TypeScript or from Flow, TypeScript with the TypeScript transpile, but Flow with that Babel transform, you need to transform your code into JavaScript. Except, there's always a little caveat. Flow as a common style, I don't think anyone uses it, but if you really, really, really don't want to use a transpile for some reason, you can write all your annotations in between in common points. And just start with slash star and then star slash and that's it. And it looks ugly and just do that. It's really easy to set up. But if you really want to, flow as that advantage over TypeScript. You technically can write pure JavaScript. But really, trouble, it takes an afternoon to trouble. It's an hour to set up. So just go out and have fun with it for a couple hours and see what you like best. And you'll probably end up going, doesn't really matter. If you use yes code, that's because you'll gain integration, that's nice. If you use Atom, flow is probably easy to integrate. Just try. Alright, so, any thoughts? So it's awesome. It really plays well with React Compiler. It forces you to think about the heck you're doing in your code, because you need to tell it what you're passing in and what you're getting out. And by the way, that also means that it kind of forces you to think functionally a little bit and not mutate variables as much anymore, because you need to be thinking about data flow and what goes in, functions, what goes out, functions, and that's not a bad kind of code to do well with mutation. Can't do it, doesn't think about it. I recommend using it from the get-go if you're starting a new project. But no one needs this code is possible. We're doing that in a startup, it's a project I'm working at. We started a few months ago. We have a very big project, it's taking a long time. But we've gotten a large part of the way already, and it's done really well. And we've caught bugs, and we've made problems faster, arguably, or disagreeably, by introducing this. It makes it really obvious to, especially in large teams, other people, what the code you wrote is doing. When that code states, here's what I expect, here's what you're going to get in return. And it makes it really obvious to you where you made mistakes, while you're making.